Good morning. Today is Thursday, April the 27th. It is 1:26. We're going to start off with Psalms 54. It's very, very short. It has orange for your faith, black for sin. A split verse. Verse 6 is split. Aleph for commandments and red for discipleship. And then it ends off with 7. Blue for your salvation. Now, this particular song was written to the chief musician Aginatar, Meshal was his name, and it is a psalm of David when Ziphim came and said to Saul, "Does not David hide himself with us? Does not David hide himself with us?" Let's begin. Verse 1 and 2 is orange for your faith. Save me, O God, by thy name, and judge me by thy strength. 2. Hear my prayer, O God. Give ear to the words of my mouth. 3. It's black. For strangers are risen up against me, and oppressors seek after my soul. They have not set God before them. Selah. Selah means think about it, America. 4 is orange for your faith. Behold, God is my helper. Hallelujah. The Lord is with them that uphold my soul. Hallelujah. All those that helped him, the Lord was with them. They knew the Lord, and the Lord was their God. So that's why they were able to help their brother when he was on the run. 5, black again, he shall reward evil unto my enemies, cut them off in thy truth. Yes, and this runs true today. Whatever you do that is evil to another, it will return unto you. It may not be today, it may not be tomorrow, it may not be next month or next year, but you shall surely pay for what you have done to another, okay, in God's time. 6 is olive for commandments, and the other part is red for discipleship. The commandment said, I will freely sacrifice unto thee. I will freely sacrifice unto thee. And the red part for discipleship says, I will praise thy name, O Lord, for it is good. Yes, it is good. And 7, our last verse is blue. For he has delivered me out of all trouble, and my eye has seen his desire upon my enemies. And this also is true. I have seen myself, my enemies, get what they truly deserve for what they have done to me. And I was there to witness it myself. Though it was a sorrowful occasion, I still remember that the Lord does return to the wicked what they have done. Okay, we are still on the topic of capital punishment. We talked about Tamara and her father. Yesterday we read about Absalom and his father, King David. Today we have 2 additional individuals who also hung on a tree. One of them, both of them begins with a J. One is Jesus Christ our Lord, and the other was Judas Issachar. Now, let me tell you a little bit about Mr. Disciple, Apostle Judas Issachar. His name Judas is the Greek form of Judah. It's the Greek form of Judah. And he was one of Christ's disciples that you can read about that in Luke 6. Judah means let him, who is him, God, be praised. That's what Judah means. Let God be praised. He was also a man of Korath. He criticized Mary in John 12. He was also the treasurer in John 13. He committed suicide in Matthew 27. We'll be reading about that today. He returns the betrayal money also in Matthew 27. He is described as a thief in John 12, callous in John 12, deceitful in Matthew 26, possessed by Satan in John 13, son of prediction in John 17, and he was also described as the devil in John 6. I do not tell you the verses because I insist that you read the chapter to yourself. You will get much out of it by reading it to yourself. So let's begin our reading for today. This is a very long It is a very long chapter. It has 66 verses, and it talks about Jesus Christ before Pilate. It talks about Jesus' crucifixion, death, and burial, and it also mentions Judah hanging. It has a significant amount of black, silver. Black is for sin, silver for history, gold for prophecy, purple for the Trinity. It has a substantial amount of black. Just about most of it is black. We have a verse of orange, 54, for your faith. We have three verses of red for discipleship. We have four verses of green for love, and then we have a significant amount of silver for history. And I have taken the liberty to include this new conventional, the new international version, so that we can flip-flop from one to the other to give you a better understanding of what it is that had occurred. Okay, let's begin. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and leaders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. Verse 2. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pilate, the governor. During that time, in the biblical time, which is the right way, the church had greater power than the politicians. Okay, the governor is a politician. The crowd that was outside crying, crucify him, crucify him, that was the church, the Jewish leaders at the time. Today is the other way around. The politicians have all the power, and the church has been muzzled. They only teach in their dens, and I will call their dens churches, okay? So they minimize where they preach, and they stay in their dens. And when our Lord was here, he often would say to you, I have no den for you. Dens are for foxes. You cannot follow me because I have no set place. You could find Jesus anywhere. You could find him. Well, if he's up in the mountains, no one could find him because he would always retreat there to rest and recollect his thought and spend time with his Father. But you can find him in the streets of Jerusalem. You can find him on a beach. You can find him in the centurion's house. You can find him in Peter's house and any of his disciples' house. You could find Jesus blended in with the people. You could not recognize him right away because he blended in with the people. And he was just everywhere. Everywhere he went, he walked there. Or he might have used a mule or a donkey. But today, these pastors, they fly, they drive Cadillacs and expensive cars. These individuals today are not servants of God. They are servants of the people. There's two different types of servants. Those that serve God and those that serve the people. Those that serve God are among the poor and do not have all these lavish lifestyles and are not rich. But those that serve the people, they are very rich. They have all kinds of things. They have planes. They are not servants of the Lord. Okay? So let's return to the reading. I'll read 2 again. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. 3. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself, so he felt awful for what he had done to our Lord. He felt terrible, okay? And brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. I don't think I need to go here to this International Version, because I think what I've said so far is very understandable. 4. Saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See thou to that. Okay, now we're going to go here, because they literally got smart with him and told him, what does that mean to us? It means nothing to us. That's what they said. Okay, we'll read it from here. I'm going to start from the beginning, since we're just starting. It says, early in the morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people came to the decision to put Christ to death. 2. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. 3. They only put Pilate here. And in the real book, it is, they deliver him to Pontius Pilate. Okay, so this is why I don't like this book, but I share it because I think it helps my audience. Okay, the governor. 3. When Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse and returned the 30 silver coins to the chief priests and the elders. 4. I have sinned, he said, for I have betrayed innocent blood. And this is their response. What is that to us? They replied, that's your responsibility. That's not what it says here. Okay? That's not what it says here. Here it says, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See thou to that. See thou to that. It doesn't necessarily mean that's your responsibility. It says, see to it. See to it. Whatever that means to you. Okay? 5. Still blank. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple. He threw them at them and departed and went and hung himself. Okay, he committed suicide. Okay, he had already done something that was bad. He made it worse when he committed suicide. He shouldn't have done that. Okay, 6 and 7 and 8 is silver for history. I will read 5 from here. So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hung himself. Very easy to understand. 6. And the chief priest took the silver pieces and said, it is not lawful for to put them into the treasury, because it is the price of blood. Oh, wow. Oh, wow, would they be so concerned about that? 7, and they took counsel and brought with them the potter's field to bury strangers. 8, wherefore that field was called the field of blood unto this day. I'm going to read that from here. The chief priest picked up the coins and said, it is against the law to put this into the treasury, since it is blood money. 7, so they decided to use the money to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. 8, that is why it has been called the field of blood to this day. It is still called the field of blood. 9 and 10 is gold for prophecy. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of him that was value, whom they of the children of Israel did value. Okay. And gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord appointed me. I will read that from here, 9 and 10. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took the 30 silver coins, the price set on him by the people of Israel, 10, and they used them to buy the potter's field as the Lord commanded. Jesus, as the Lord commanded. 11, 12, 13, and 14 are purple for the Trinity. Okay? This is our Lord now. And Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, saying, "Art thou the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said unto him, "Thou sayest." That means you said it. That means that which you said is true. You said it. Okay? 12. And when he was accused of the chief priests and elders, he answered nothing. 13. Then said Pilate unto him, "Hearest thou not how many things they witness against thee?" And he said, "Do you not hear all these things that they are accusing you of?" Still, our Lord is silent. There's a time to speak, and there's a time to keep silent. We learn this in this chapter just by listening to how our Lord responded. Okay. 14. And he answered him to never a word, insomuch that the governor marveled greatly. He didn't never say a word. After he said, "Thou sayest," he never said another word. Let me take it here. It says, 11. Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. That's a lot of words. He only said two words, "Thou sayest." Thou sayest. That's all he said. He didn't say all these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 words. No, he said, "Thou sayest," which means what you said is right. "Thou sayest." And here says, "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. 12. When he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. 13. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear the testimonies they are bringing against you?" 14. But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. Okay, let's go back here. 15, 16, and 17 is history. And it says, now at that feast, the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would. 16. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. Barabbas would be like a modern day, what is his name? He's still alive today. Can't think of his name for some reason, Father. He is alive today. He was the leader of a group that committed a hideous crime in the 1970s, even cutting out the unborn fetus from a woman, unborn child from a woman. I will think of it before we're finished. But He is the exact type of person. Charles Manson, okay? So Barabbas would be like a Charles Manson of today that is still living in prison, okay? 17, therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, "Whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ?" I will read it from 17 here. Even though it's easy to understand, I just want, the Spirit leads me to read it from here also. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" 18, for he knew it was out of envy that they had hung Jesus over to him, handed Jesus over to him. So Pilate was not a dumb man. He knew exactly what was going on, but he had a wife that was spiritual, okay? And she, normally, a woman does not interfere, especially in the biblical times, in the work of her husband, especially if he's in a position that Pilate was in. But this thing was so strong in her spirit that it led her to speak to her husband. And it also led her husband to ask her questions that he did not understand. Let's continue. I'll start from 15. Now at that feast, the governor was one to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. 17. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, Whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ? 18. For he knew that for envy they had delivered him. He knew that the man didn't do anything wrong. He knew that the man was special. He knew that it was so envy that drove that mad crowd outside. And the crowd was so huge. It was like a crowd that I recently seen on YouTube. And everybody had a sign talking about how important science was. It was a crowd like that. I really had hoped the Lord would have opened up the ground where they were standing. 19, which is gold for prophecy. When he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, Have nothing to do with that just man. Okay? So that is verification that what he was thinking was correct. The man did nothing wrong. Nothing. He preached, he teached, he cured, he brought people back to life. He rescued a woman from being stoned. These are all good things he did. But for that, he paid with his life. For that. So she says, have nothing to do with that just man, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. So the Lord God gave her a vision in her dream. And this led to her speaking to her husband regarding the just man that they were wanting to crucify. I will read it from here. While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message. Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal tonight in a dream because of him. Okay, now we're going to go from 20 to 31, and it's going to be all black America, all black. But the chief priests and the elders who should have recognized our Lord, they should have recognized him. If they didn't recognize him, the Lord said, look at the things that I've done. And still yet, they refused to acknowledge who he was, the Son of God. They rather believed that he was working through the force of the devil. But the chief priests and elders persuade the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. 21. The governor answered and said unto them, Whither of the twine will ye that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate, 22. Pilate saith unto them, What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all said unto him, Let him be crucified. Now, this is a crowd of people, similar to that same crowd of people that was trying to speak up for how important science is. Yes, we'll talk about that later. 23. And the governor said, Why? What evil has he done? Okay. But they cried out more loudly, saying, Let him be crucified. I don't need to go there. 24. When Pilate saw that he could not prevail nothing, that rather a turmoil was made, he took water and washed his hand before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. 25. Then answered all the people and said, His blood be on us and on our children. Okay. I'm going to read this one more time and I'm going to take you somewhere. Then answered the people and said, his blood be on us and on our children. Okay, so what you were saying, let his blood be on us and on our children. You're talking about generations now. You are cursing your generations of children. Now I'm going to take you to the Holocaust. Many Jews died at the hands of my evil brother, Hitler. Many. Did I, when I read the history of that, feel sorry for them Jews? Absolutely not. Because their forefathers are these people right here saying, let their blood be on us and our children. It says, then answer all the people. And they say, his blood be on us and on our children. Those people that suffer at the hands of Nazi were the children of these people right here. That's why I felt nothing for them. Because their forefathers had committed a hideous crime to a holy man. And the price had to be paid. Sometimes the Lord doesn't make you pay for it right away for what you do. Sometimes he waits generations to generations to generations. And then in his own time, he chooses a generation to punish. And that happened to be those at the hand of Hitler. 26. Then released he Barabbas unto. Now that sounds cold, but what I'm reading here was colder. None of those Jews that died at the hands of Hitler were holy like this holy man here. Not one. None of the men were the Son of God. Not one. None of them was as worthy as this one man. Not one or all of them combined. 26. Then released he Barabbas unto them, and when he had scorned Jesus, we read about that before. What does that mean? He was beaten with a whip first. They hit him, I don't know how many times with that whip, over 50 times with the whip. And when our Lord stood up as if he hadn't been struck one time, they took another whip with metal pieces on it. That each time it struck the body of our Lord, it took meat. Excuse me. Excuse me. 26. Excuse me, Father. Then released he Barabbas unto them. And when he had scorned, when they had scorned Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. 27. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers. And of course, even the soldiers took part in torturing our Lord. Even the soldiers took part in it. Okay. Excuse me. 28. And they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. 29. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon him and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed the knees before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of Jews." That's with an exclamation mark. 30. And they spit upon him and took the reed and smote him on the head. So they spit on him and they pressed the reed down on his head and they spit on our Lord. That's what they did. They spit on him, okay, and took the reed and smote him on the head. So they smacked him in the head. 31. And after that, they had mocked him and took the robe off from him and put on his own remnants on him and led him away to be crucified. That is all black. 32-34. I don't think I need to read this from the conventional, because you should be able to understand what's going on. 32. And as they came out, they found a man, Simon by name. This man was just walking by. He had absolutely nothing to do with what was going on. He was on his own mission. Excuse me. Oh, God. He was on his own mission. And they made him carry the tree for our Lord. God, I hope that's just lipstick and not blood. Excuse me. Okay. And as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simeon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross, so they made him carry the tree for him. His name is Simon. 33. And when they were come into a place called Golgotha, that is said, a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink, mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink of it. 35 is a split verse, a very long one, part black and part gold for prophecy. Excuse me. And they crucified him and parted his garment, casting lots. That's the black part. The gold part said, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, they parted my garments among them, and upon my vestures did they cast lots. Okay. 36 and 37 is silver. And sitting down, they watched him there. 37, and set up over his head his accusations written. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Okay. 38 to 44 is black. Then there were two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and the other on the left. 39, and they that passed by revived him, wagging their heads. 40, and saying, "Thou that destroyed the temple and buildeth it in 3 days, save thyself if thou be the Son of God. Come down from the tree." I will read that from here. It's mockery. It is mockery, America. 39. Those who passed by heard or insults at him, shaking their heads. 40, and said, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself, ! Come down from the cross if you are the Son of Man, the Son of God, ! Okay, 41. Likewise, also the chief priests mocking him with the scribes and elders, saying, 42, he saved others. Himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe him. If he had came down from that cross, he would have been doing something that was simple. He came to be a sacrifice for our sins, for us now and for us forevermore, okay? That was the last leg of his journey here on earth. He's not going to disobey his Father to prove anything to man. All right? If all the miracles he did not convince those fools, coming down off that tree would not convince them either. 42, I'll read it again. He saved others. Himself, he could not save. If he were with the king of, if he be the king of Israel, let him come down now from the cross and we will believe him. 43, he trusted in God. Let him deliver him now if he will have him. For he said, I am the Son of God. 44, the thief also, which was crucified with him, cast the same in his teeth. Now one of the thieves was a good, just man, and the other one was the devil himself. All right? Now, the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land into the ninth hour. That means the whole earth, ladies and gentlemen. That doesn't just mean that regional area. It means the whole earth became dark. The whole earth became dark, not just that region. All right. Now, the sixth hour, there was darkness over the land unto the ninth hour. 46 is purple for the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That is what those words mean. 47. Some of them that stood there when they heard that said, this man calleth for Elias. 48. And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him to drink. 49. The rest said, let us see whether Elijah will come down to save him. 50 is silver, is purple for the Trinity. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yield up the ghost. 51 to 53 is silk, is blue for your salvation. And behold, the veil of the temple was writ in twine from the top to the bottom. The earth did shake and the rocks rent. Okay, in the same way that I said to you, the whole earth became dark. It was the whole earth that became dark. Okay? The whole earth also shook. Okay? Rocks fell. All of this happening at the same time. All right? And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did shake, and the rocks rent. 52, and the graves was open, and the graves were open, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose. Did you hear me? The graves were open. So all those that had been buried were walking out of their graves on that day. That's what that means. I will read it from here. 51. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. 52. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people who had died was raised to life. And on the day he returned, it will be the same way. Holy people, not the evil ones, the holy ones. It says it here. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people, not the evil ones, okay, and came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many. 54 is orange for your faith. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, "Truly, this was the Son of God." Look what it took, ladies and gentlemen. Look what it took. It took his death. It took darkness. It took shaking of the earth. It took rocks splitting in half for them to realize that they had killed a just, holy man. None of the miracles helped. None of the people he called from the dead helped. None of that helped. 55, 56, and 57 is red for discipleship. I never read that to you, but I will read red to you tomorrow. I want to finish this because we're almost there. And many women were there, beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him. 56. Among which were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of Jesus and Joas, and the mother of Zebedee's children. 57. When the evening was come, there came a rich man, Arimathea, named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. So Jesus had all kinds of disciples and apostles, rich and poor, or you could say low and great. 58 to 61 is green for love. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. 59. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth. Bless him. 60. And laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewed out in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulchre and departed. 61. And there was Mary Magdalene and other Mary sitting over against the sepulchre. 62. Now, the next day that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate. So they come to Pilate again. Okay, scheming. More scheming. 63, saying, "Sir, we remember that the deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again. 64, command there that the supreme be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead, so that the last error should be worse than the first." Okay. So they went to the pilot. And because even though the earth has shooken, the rocks had split, the earth had gotten dark, and they had realized they made a mistake and killed a just, holy man, they were still being deceitful. They were still non-believers. They set guards over the tomb where our Lord was because they were afraid that God wasn't able to fulfill the last portion of his journey here. If he said in 3 days he would return, in 3 days he returned. Okay? There's 64 says, "Command therefore that the serpent be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead, so the last error should be worse than the first." I'm going to read that from here. 62, the guard at the tomb. The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. 62, "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, go after 3 days, I will rise again. 64, so give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he had been risen from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first. Okay. 65. Pilate said unto them, ye have a watch. Go your way. Make it as sure as you can. Okay, I will read that one too. Take a guard, Pilate answered. Go make the tomb as secure as you know how. 66, the last verse. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. Here, so they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. Man can be awfully deceptive. Awfully deceptive. Even today, they are deceptive. It is just the nature of man. God knew this. This is why he made it where two of the same kind cannot produce a child, because he knows the mind and the wickedness of man. Huh? This is why he does the things he does. This is why he punishes us the way he does. And it is not over yet, America. It's going to get worse before it gets better. But I tell you, save yourself. Repent. For the kingdom of God is at hand. Have you heard that before? It is true. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Don't be caught on the wrong side of the spectrum. If you can help it, save yourself. Read your Bible. Get acquainted with your God, our Lord, our Master, our Rabbi. So because the day of doom is coming, let it be that you are among the ones that receive a saving angel. There are two types of angels, okay? There's a pickup angel and there's a saving angel. Unlike man, angels do not fail at their duties. If it is their job to save you, you will be saved. If it is their job to pick you up, you will be picked up. You want the Lord to hear you when trouble comes your way. You want the Lord to listen to your cries when you have a problem. You want the Lord to hear you all the time. So repent for your sins. Get closer to him. Build your salvation with the Lord, the God of this universe. And you will be saving yourself a whole lot of grief upon the day of trouble. I hope you got something out of it. And I will not apologize for my tears. I will not apologize for anything I said. Because everything that I said, I read it from the book. These words are older than any civil or federal law made by man. These words are holy words. I cannot go wrong reading that which is holy. And I can never go wrong expressing my sorrow for that which my forefathers have done. I hope you got something out of it. I encourage you to help somebody, not someone that can return the favor to you, someone who cannot. I encourage you to teach your children the laws of God. And I encourage you to build your relationship with him, because this land, this earth is more evil than it's ever been. The evil that goes on here in this world is more evil, and it makes Sodom and Gomorrah look like angels. In the meantime, may the peace of God be upon your path. May the protection of God surround you and your family. And may the will of God come from you. Until the next time, thank you very much for joining me here at Spiritual Water. My name is Brenda Guerrero. Enjoy the rest of your day.